Hey, my fellow parents. Hey, dreams really do come true. I'm a 44-year-old man, but back in the day, once upon a time, I was just a kid. I was just a teenager with a dream, and I had a dream. I want to have a family one day. Oh, I want to be a dad. I want to be a husband, and I could envision it. I really could. I can envision having my kids around a Christmas tree, and the hugs and the kisses and the adventures and the trips. And some dreams really do come true. And now here we are. Here I am. Here you are. Maybe you dreamed of having kids your whole life, or maybe they were a big surprise. Who knows? But we're here because we love these kids so much. We want them to be happy and healthy. And we want them to love each other because, oh my gosh, we all want happy siblings and happy homes. But oh my gosh, they fight. They fight, Jordan. They're nasty to each other. They pick on each other. They bully each other. They're jealous of each other. They freaking annoy each other. They annoy us. Oh my gosh, one of my biggest regrets in life, and I'm saying this very sober-minded. One of my biggest regrets in life is how I treated my sister Megan. I've got two sisters, but how I treated my younger sister Megan growing up, I still feel horrible about it. She's forgiven me. I remember I had numerous meetings with her when we were in our 20s, when I looked her in the eye and I said, "I'm just so sorry for how I bullied you, how I called you names, how I didn't love you. I failed you as a brother, as a human being." I treated her, and I'll tell you some things another time when I feel like I have the courage to share some of these stories. But she was a sweet, sweet girl, a lovely girl, and she did not deserve to be treated that way by her brother. And so we're here today to encourage you, to empower you, and to make you laugh and to tell stories because, sibling fighting. This is only part one, two of this series. So Jordan, why do you think, man, you didn't know me back then when I was a high school student, middle school kid, but why was I so mean to my sister Jordan, or to my sister Megan Jordan?
I don't know, man. I mean, you were always such like a helpful mentor to me. I can't see that side of you, but I mean, without knowing more about the dynamic, I go straight to thinking, okay, so you had Sean Donahue and you got two sisters, one older and one younger.
Right.
So can we assume that you were a middle child in this family dynamic?
Yeah, middle child, older sister is 3, 4 years older. But I mean, she was always just like, my parents divorced. She even lived with my dad, and we lived with my mom. So yeah, I just wish I could go back and talk to that little guy, Sean, and say,
I
"Stop
know,
doing
I
this, man.
know.
What are you
I mean,
thinking?"
everybody comes up with like this idea of like middle child syndrome. Maybe
Oh, okay.
there's some truth into that. I mean, maybe you felt, a sense. I mean, when you're in the middle, you kind of get lost, right? You're not the first, you're not the baby, so you're not getting baby. You're just kind of there and in the middle. And so maybe this was a way for you to find a way to get control and get attention is to like bullying your sister.
I know. I know I could tell you a list of 5 things my dad and I have in common. One thing for sure is that it drove him nuts when I would pick on my little sister. And man, it drives me bonkers when I see one of the older, bigger siblings, picking on or bullying a younger sister. My dad used to wash my mouth out with bar soap. But I remember vividly, Jordan, when there's no bar soap handy, we even mentioned this, I think, a couple episodes ago, that dude would grab Liquid Dial, the orange
Oh.
kind that was big in the 80s, straight up grab me and squirt, squirt, squirt in my mouth.
You're
If I was gonna cuss, be out, talk out, or if I was rude to my sister. But this is the problem with discipline. It didn't like do
didn't
anything
help.
for me. It didn't change anything. It
You were
gave me
just
some.
burping up bubbles later.
Oh, dude, so nasty. Burping up bubbles and gave me a story to tell on a podcast 25 years later, but it didn't really reach my heart. And that's really what we want to do with these kids. We want to reach their hearts, and that's where all the action is. This is why star charts do not work. This is why timeouts, 1, 2, 3s. This is why punishment, spankings, they don't work. It's because these things don't, sometimes, in my opinion, most of the time, they don't reach their hearts. And that's what we want, because you've got 3 kids and you got a set of twins. So,
Yeah.
I mean, do they fight with each
I
other?
mean, thankfully, no. God bless me with perfect children. They never fight. They go to bed on time. They say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am. I mean, they help in the kitchen. It's amazing. I'm just like, oh my gosh, I should have 20 of these kids. If only life was that easy, right? It is so difficult. I mean, I like where you're going with this and trying to speak to their heart. And I'll get to my story in a second, but I think this is a question that will be answered throughout this podcast. Is like it is difficult to speak to these kids' hearts mm-hmm. when they're not mature enough to understand that. I don't know if someone tried to do that to you when you were a kid and you were a bully to your sister. Do you think you were at the age where you could have received that in that moment? Or was that something that comes with age later in life?
I don't know. I don't know if my parents tried to speak to my heart. Let's assume they did. But then why didn't it really get through to my heart? Was it them? Was it their poor speaking? Was it my closed heart? This is what we're going to try to solve these problems today, because I've got good news for y'all. I've been working with your sons and daughters and with you for 24 years, and I found some tools, some strategies, some do's and don'ts about how to thrive with sibling fighting, how to stop it, and to create homes of sibling love and harmony. Because Jordan, I didn't know this until I learned this from other clients, that for some parents that are listening to this right now, their number one dream in life is to have the siblings love each other like best friends.
Yeah, that's my goal too.
Like, really, like, it's like best friends. Like, we want you guys to be the best, closest friends. I've never really even, that's just not on my radar. Maybe it's from my childhood. But so that's not only on your radar, but that's up there.
That's all our hope, right? That our hope is when they leave the house, they call each other maybe every day to check in on each other without us knowing as parents. Maybe they meet up for dinner. Maybe, you know, they live in the same town. Maybe they have jobs close to each other. And we're getting older now, and we're moving on to the next chapter of our lives as adults. And my hope, is that they stay close. But that's a tough task.
And it is tough, but when Luke Bryan sings about that song "Blood Brothers," I do think, like, dude, I wish I had a brother like that. You're right; that's dreamy, right? So tell us more, because like sibling issues are tough, but like we could have a whole episode on thriving with twins, because I think like even like twins demographic does not get enough support as it could. It's like a different type of parenting in a sense.
Yeah.
Like
you could break that up into different kind of twins. I mean, we have fraternal twins, boy, girl twins, but I mean, what if we had boy, boy twins or girl, girl twins? What if they were identical twins? And yet you have two individuals that are like the same, but they don't like the same things. Right. And so that could get complicated, but for my twins,
so complicated.
I've got a boy, a girl, one's all boy and one's all girl. And by that, I mean, like, what do you do when you're a little boy toddler? You wreck things, you jump on stuff, you break things, you're just a boy, right? You get dirty. And then my girl's dainty. She loves now going to get her nails done with my wife. And I love it. And they're so different. But they shared a womb together. I mean, they're sharing every aspect of life together. And yes, they fight like any sibling fights. Yes. I try to teach them, like, guys, you could be so powerful in this world if you just work together.
Yes.
Even gotten to the point Dream where I'm team. Like, listen, I mean, I could be mad at you, and if you work together, you guys, when you get older, could outsmart me. And honestly, I'm probably not going to get mad at that if you start working together and outsmart me.
Yeah.
Because I'm trying to teach them, like, if you divide, it's not going to be easy. If you could stay strong together, if one's getting bullied at school, the other one's got to step in and help that other person. And don't try and be cool in front of your friends. And it's hard, okay? Like,
super hard.
My kids definitely have their individuality to them, and they want to be cool with their friends, and they're trying to keep things separate. But of course, they do love each other, and I see it from time to time, and I love it. You know, I love when they work together, but I'm very fortunate. I think I've just, like, I don't know if it's just use your teachings. I've partnered up with an amazing spouse who, like, is really wise in the way she teaches them to, you know, come back to each other and be mindful of each other. But I remember when I was growing up, I witnessed, you know, a situation that was completely opposite. I mean, we were growing up in, I think a lot of time I was in Las Vegas. Parents were in the process of going through a divorce. And anyway, I was just out playing. And I remember this kid on his bike on the ground, just bawling. Hmm. And this boy on top of him with his foot on the bike, pinning this other younger boy down and like hitting him, physically like hitting him. Yeah. And we go up to him, and then we come to realize that's his older brother doing that to this young kid.
Horrible.
It is absolutely horrible.
We got to talk about that.
unfortunately, I that happens a lot. And you, your question is spot on. Why does that happen? I don't know. Attention, or you want superiority?
So many reasons, right? Two stories came to mind listening to that story. One is I used to be a Christian youth pastor and is in a couple different churches. And I also worked in various nonprofits. Some were just after school programs, some were Christian based, some were not. And I had triplets once in my group.
No.
And they were involved a lot for all 4 years of high school. The Smith twins, Lewis, Amber, and Colette. And they talk about a dream come true. It was like a dream team triplets. And their parents were so loving and nice and wonderful. And they had a brother, a special needs brother, and an older sister, a lovely family. But when you think about this teaming up, like these three triplets were popular for all the right reasons. They had different hobbies, different skill sets, but it was like everyone knew, like, this is like the triplets. And it's like, that's what you want for our siblings or our twins. That's the dream. Second story that comes to mind is your wife, Danny, texted my wife, Danielle, a picture of your daughter grabbing your son's shirt and just bothering. She was just bothering him. And he's like being patient with her, and she's leaning up and he's leaning away, and she doesn't let go of the shirt. Then he gets a little more physical. She doesn't let go. And I think Danny texted us in the group chat and says, I need help with this. But like, there was no violence, no hitting. But it's like, you say your girl is like dainty and sweet, but not in that video. She's
dating
her brother on. That's a day in the life, though, right?
And what is it? It's like, you know, it's like I put my hand up in front of your face. I'm not touching you. 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 Or the mimicking, right? It's like they're mimicking each other. I'm like, guys, what are you? You're purposely trying to annoy everyone in this car right now. Why are you copycatting each other? What is that?
Jerks.
I was going to say, we got a snapshot of your childhood. I want to know what, you know, if you're willing to share a story from your kids if they fight.
Oh, gosh. Well, part of the problem, every house has problems. Like one of my clients right now, they've got twins, and one brother is like an alpha male, like very into hygiene, very into good grades. And his brother is really into more low-key, introverted, more into screens, and not into hygiene. In fact, it's kind of a problem for him. He's a teenager, and he just struggles with hygiene. So this really pushes the other brother's buttons, because he's like, he probably gets embarrassed by his brother, right? Because like, you're looking like you roll out of bed, you're wearing freaking Pokemon pajamas, and we're like, you know, sophomores in high school. Because see, that's the problem with siblings and like even twins, is like you like represent each other out there in the real world. And that's just one of a million things that can go wrong. And another thing that can cause problems is like my kids are 18, you know, 13 and 6. So really they just have different brains. They think differently, different hobbies, different ways of understanding life. And it's just, they're constantly bothering each other because they're so different than each other.
Maybe that's it. You know, and I'm trying to think here, going back to our original question, why do siblings fight? And one of the things that came up in my mind was they are in a tight space together, a home, let's say, or an apartment, or I don't know where you are. You go to school, you ride the bus, you go in a car, you're out together all the dang time. And you're trying to figure out maybe how far can I go until they pop, or maybe this is just like a learning process of like, I'm just trying to learn their tells, like what bugs them, what doesn't. And they do it in like a mischievous way, but maybe deep down that's what they're trying to figure out, or we're all trying to figure out.
I like that image that you said. And I want for all of you listening to this to even remember that image, like just these people living in these small spaces together. Because my job is to try to help bring some clarity and bring some simplicity to this complicated topic. Because I can tell you on one hand, something more psychological, but then only allow me to even compare it to something on the other hand, which is more simple. Yes, on one hand, and I'm holding up a document, which I give to all the clients. You can see all of my tools, my PDFs, if you join any of my membership programs or if you're a one-on-one client. In question 3 of this document, it's like a high-level EQ assessment written for middle schoolers all the way up to parents. It asks you, what do you truly desire or want to experience in life and relationships? And most sixth grade kids can actually answer this document. It's very high level, though. It's like schools won't teach us what they should teach emotional intelligence in schools. So I'll just read a few of the words right off the page. Start with A's. It's an ABC order. If you read these words, realize this is what you want to experience in life and parenting. And this is what your little children, whether they're 2 or 22, want to experience in life. Everybody, but we all want to feel it on different levels. It's like, think of it like, how would you narrow these down to your top 5? Everybody wants to feel acceptance, accurately portrayed, adequate, affection, appreciation, approval, assistance, attention, care, comfort, commitment, companionship, / quality time, competitive, competence, connection, creative, and artistic. I just stopped at the C's. But don't you agree? Those are all amazing human emotions, right?
Oh, yeah. But I'm trying to think if our children or us mm-hmm. as kids had yep. all of that, would we not annoy our sibling?
Well, this is where my response is that we can find healthy ways of getting our desires met or unhealthy ways. And what our children are doing is they're finding healthy and unhealthy ways of getting these desires met. For example, attention. So why would a 9-year-old twin named Emery grab her brother's shirt and just pull it and grab it? Well, she's trying to get her I call them desires, not needs, because she's not going to die without him. She's trying to get her desires met. Sure. What are her desires in that moment of this video?
Which a became, toy or whatever she, it was.
She
yeah.
wants to feel companionship. Maybe she wants to feel affection. Maybe she wants attention. Maybe she wants, right? Those are just 3 things. And is sure. she going about getting those in healthy ways or unhealthy? Probably unhealthy for her bro, right? It's like, girl, you want to hang out with me?
Yeah.
Like, why are you grabbing my jersey? And then right. what's going to happen? He's going to turn. He's going to hit her. And then blah, blah, blah. Right.
right. Well, she started it. No, he started right. it. Well, she did this. Right. Oh, yeah. Finger pointing.
So then
like
he's
going
to want to feel his desire is pretty met. He wants to feel heard. So he says, stop. And she doesn't stop. So now he's getting his buttons pushed. He's feeling powerless. He's feeling unheard. And now he's got to make a choice. Am I going to manage these emotions well or poorly? And that's a lot to ask for a 9-year-old. Do you feel on me?
Yeah. Oh, 100% feel on you. That's hard for anybody to manage, even as an adult.
Imagine me. If I was grabbing your clothes.
Right.
Right? Or hanging out. You're like, stop, Sean. And I just didn't stop.
Right.
Like, what would you do?
I would just right? be like, yeah, you're right.
You would probably get physical with me.
You got it. Right? Well, first I would get firm with my voice. Dude, Sean, stop. Yeah. I said stop, you know, well, like right. show that you're serious.
Right. right. Or, I mean, yeah, I mean, in the list goes on. Let's say I was putting my hands on even some of your special belongings, touching your stuff, right? Or like, you know, your special Emmys that you've won or
whatever. Yeah.
It's like the list is continuing. This is what our kids are doing. They're just right. going about selfishly trying to do things that feel good. And that word selfish, partnered with the word selflessness, is one of the simple ways that we can blow away the fog of all this crazy sibling stuff. So let me tell you, let me ask you, Amin. So you got, okay, you've got your 2 twins. You said they're 9, right?
Yeah.
Okay, you got 1 twin, 2 twins. And then you've got Kinlan, who's got Down syndrome. And I think he just turned 4 as we
That's
record
right.
this.
Yeah.
All right, so tell me, is there any sibling issues going on with the 4-year-old? Or do they pick on him? Do
That's
they
great.
Get jealous
no.
of him? Do they feel like they don't get enough attention?
That's
I mean,
a great question, because we do favor Kinlan a lot because the kids are 9. They can almost take care of themselves. Mom, I'm hungry. Okay. Can you make me food? No, you're 9. Yeah. You can go in the fridge and get your own dang food. You know what I mean?
But then you do all this stuff for a 4-year-old.
We do all this stuff for a 4-year-old. Mom, would you mind? Right. Here, let Emery or Kaden. Mom, would you mind, you know, tucking me into bed? Nope, can't. Got to go put Kinlan to bed, right? So he's right. getting unfavorably yeah. more attention than them.
Yeah.
I don't
And that's probably
going
to be the case for their entire childhood.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, we've done a great job with being as open as possible with him. Like, hey, he's going to be non-typical. We need to, you know, make yeah. sure that we are kind to him. But what's amazing is I don't know if they've given him a pass. And if they do feel any kind of jealousy, it has not been, I'm not aware of it. I don't see it. They're really understanding. It seems okay. Unless it comes out in different ways. But what I love is there is no sibling rivalry between them and Kinlan. The rivalry comes with the twins, and Kinlan yeah. is like separate. And so what's actually pretty amazing with him is, like, you know, kids with Down syndrome, they They're just so kind-hearted. So like the other day, Emery got hurt and
Yeah.
she was crying and Kinlan was
Oh
playing
my
and he dropped the ball and
gosh.
he just walked over and gave her a hug. It was the sweetest thing in the
Oh, what an
world.
angel.
I was like, oh my gosh,
Oh,
this is everything.
I'm gonna be
So
like
I'm
him.
thankful for that. You know, I'm very thankful. And I honestly think having a non-typical child is teaching my twins how to care and love for each other as
Oh
siblings.
gosh,
You know, without
yes.
them, I don't know if they would really understand it than with him. So that's helpful
Yeah.
for me. That's looking at the glass half full, life throwing you a curveball, and you're really like, wow, this is actually a huge gift. This is helping out.
Everybody, let's just all learn from what Jordan just said. Think of your most challenging child right now and realize that they are our blessing. They are our gift. They are our teachers, teaching us about love and about presence and about connection and about healing. So thank you for sharing that, man. Now, let me ask you a question. So living with a 4-year-old, just being honest with you, I've lived with 3 4-year-olds. I mean, it's pretty annoying. It's pretty challenging. And so, like, I'm guessing I would probably do well living with a 4-year-old because I have like a lot of experience. And I'm like, this is what I do for a freaking job. But you got 9-year-old twins. Did they get bothered by their 4-year-old? Does he pick on them? Does he tease them? Does he just make noises like a normal 4-year-old? Does he
The
like does
only
he do they like lash out at him for being 4?
Yeah, like we're working on a Lego set thing right now, right? Me and my 9-year-old boy, and we're trying to do this baby Yoda, and it takes a lot of pieces, right?
Okay,
And
yeah.
Kinlan wants to be a part of that, so he'll come up and grab stuff, and then you'll be like,
Oh
Kinlan,
yeah.
no, don't touch it. You're gonna
Yeah,
ruin
right.
it. You're gonna ruin
Exactly.
it
Everyday life, yeah.
every day. Or he'll just go in the kitchen, start opening drawers, throwing everything on the ground. My wife hates it when he just goes in the laundry room, messes up all the folded laundry. You're like, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah,
That
right.
comes with the 4-year-old
He's
territory.
4.
He's four. He's gonna get into trouble. But I mean, he just wants to do what they want to do. So I think the
He
biggest thing
does. Oh.
is, and I think that, you know, let's think about it. Any 4-year-old looks up to their siblings. They want to do what their siblings are doing, right? They're
Yeah.
sponges. They're taking everything in. And maybe they want to do what their parents are doing. Whatever it is, they just want to be a part of the action. And so
They
sometimes I
do.
think for older people, that can be a little annoying because then we have to slow down and maybe
Yes.
teach them. Or maybe we're playing basketball and we can't play the way we normally can. We have to
Yes.
slow down on the trampoline and
Yeah.
make sure he
It's
doesn't
not
get
about
hurt.
you.
It's
It's
not
not
about
about you.
you.
It's not about you and yourself. This is like one of the things that helps me to thrive during the bedroom routines, which is super hard for me, is I realize the reason why my daughters have all stalled and why almost all kids stall around nighttime in the bedroom routine is because of what you just said.
They want to be
They
with us?
want to be with us. And if you actually think about how the majority of human beings have lived in the history of humanization, and we didn't have these huge houses with all these different bedrooms. Co-sleeping has been a normal part of the human experience for a long time. So yeah, it's hard for all kids, harder for some kids, others to separate and leave their family members at nighttime to go in the room and then they shut the door.
My gosh, I've
So,
never thought about that. That's crazy. You're right. Historically, we like we're in huts all together,
Isn't
and
that?
now we're putting them in this area by themselves, and then we have to go into like being afraid of the night. I was scared of the night as a kid too, you know? And it's like, well, good luck. We'll see you on the other side of this thing.
Good luck,
And
buddy.
good luck
Sweet
sleeping tonight,
dreams.
sweet dreams.
Here's a new stuffy with a giraffe. And then
Right.
let me try to be funny. Then you add in that we did this last episode. We're a generation of scared parents. So now our kids are maybe watching a little PG-13, a little rated R, or they have a
Yeah.
parent be like, yeah, be careful out there. There's bad people out there. There's bad people out there. Okay,
Right.
it's time to go to bed. Let's brush your teeth. Right? So then they're watching all
Yes.
these Disney shows, all these ghosts and ghouls and goblins. And we're like, we're here. It's okay. It's okay. It's a cartoon. It's a cartoon. Okay, good night time. See ya. I'll see you in 8 hours. You better not come out. Right? Stay in your
So,
dungeon.
I mean, you know, there's a lot of stuff I've kind of seen, you know, with them, and it's fun as they get older and how it's all evolving. But there is something there, that's just I can't put my finger on it. So, is it jealousy? Is it attention? It's all those things you listed, but thankfully, the annoyance hasn't been problematic for us when it comes to the 4-year-old versus the 9-year-old. But I mean, with your own kids, and even just thinking back in our childhood, the way you acted toward your sister, or my younger sister acted towards me and my brother who are older, there was that same dynamic, and I don't know what it is.
I think, Jordan, because sibling fighting is not like it's what you have in your home. It's what you probably have is you have a tolerable situation with the sibling fighting. But some people listen to this, they have what I would call an intolerable situation. It's intolerable. Like so many car rides are so ruined. Evenings are ruined. Vacations are ruined. I even know some families that when the kids become teenagers, they don't even vacation as a family. They have to split up because the siblings are so mean and so selfish. So if you have an intolerable situation, well, then you definitely need to contact me or do one of my courses to figure out the core root of the issue, because there is an answer. So for example, I mean, there's like a million scenarios, but here's one example. You know, it's very common for one sibling, usually it's the older sibling, to want to parent the younger sibling. Have you seen that much?
100%. The firstborn typically does that.
Mm-hmm. And that causes problems because the parents don't want the parent, you know, the parents don't want the kid being the parent, and the kid being parented doesn't want. But there's normally a root, like cause or desire, or a button that's driving that, right? It could be, I like feeling power. It's like, I don't like the way they do the dishes, and I need to be taught how to do the dishes correctly. And they just, it all, so much of it has to do with like us being their emotion coaches and helping them to figure out what is going on inside of them, like being around, you know, their siblings. And that's really what we're going to focus on in the last part of our episode here today.
You know, yeah. So. And I was thinking like personality types, right? You say, oh, that person's an A-type personality. They like to take control. And I could see that already developing in my kids. And I don't know if that's something I'm instilling into them or if that's with them at their core, but can I already see one of my kids being mother hen or, you know, just making sure everything's in order. Meanwhile, the other one maybe is a little bit more chaos driven, you know, and I don't know where that comes from either.
Yeah. Let me tell you, this might sound a little funny what I'm about to say, but let me tell you one of the keys that I have found to thriving with the sibling issues in our home. And then let me just tell you, let me ask you that same question. Like how you manage sibling? Here's one. This is like a real raw, this is me not putting on my parent coach hat. This is just me putting on my dad hat right now. Is that the fact is that kids are freaking annoying. They're annoying. Living with a 4-year-old is so hard. It's annoying. A 7-year-old, oh my gosh. 11-year-olds, they feel like they know it all. Living with a 13-year-old, come on. Living with a 17-year-old who's barely home and thinks that they just like can come and go because they're almost 18, that is so annoying. It is so tough. So here is what you do with this, is that you help your kids understand like, yeah, it's hard. It's hard. Let's just say she's 6, guys. Yeah. You were annoying and you were really hard at age 6 too. This is normal. So what are you going to do about it? Oh my gosh, my brother. It's so this. Yeah, I know. It's tough. I get annoyed by that too. You do?
Right.
Right. Yeah. What are you going to do about it? Well, go do that. Yeah, we could do that or we could not do that. It's like, so just having that. See, when you, without calling someone a name or calling them annoying, but what we're kind of like, what I'm trying to like do here is just like have compassion, like helping kids understand that it's challenging living with roommates mm-hmm. who are different than you. And it's okay because this is life. So instead of trying to get them to accept each other or just don't blame them or concentrate on the positive or some cheesy pep talk or punishing them because they have a bad attitude. Instead, what I'm saying, yeah, just admit it. It's tough.
Right.
This is tough. Just realize.
You're putting the thought process into the child as to go a little deeper. On the surface, it's this. But let's go a little deeper and figure out the why. Well,
yeah, man.
Because they're 4.
They're 4.
Now let's go a little deeper. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do about it? Mm-hmm. Oh, wait. I get to choose what I get to do that he's annoying. Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's annoying. So what are you going to do about it?
Yeah.
Oh, I guess I was just going to complain, but now I have a choice of how I want to react.
Yeah. You want to let that ruin your day? You want to let that ruin your day because you have a 4-year-old brother who has Down syndrome. So you have an 11-year-old sister or a 13-year-old brother who is going through hormones and they're going through a hard time in middle school. And this is what normal people do that are going through hard times. Right? And it is annoying. And we live with this person and we love them. So what are we going to do about it?
I love that. That is so wise.
Pretty simple. pretty simple. Just simple.
So that's a method, you know, to this madness.
How about you? I got lots. I'm going to share some when we get to the Ask the Family Coach section. I'm going to share some more. But how about in the Steele Higley home? So yes, Jordan Steele Higley is your full name. What do Jordan and Danny do? What are some tips, some strategies you guys do to thrive with three kids, 9 and under?
So we do a lot of family talks. First off, from a parenting perspective, we got to figure out as parents what our kids are going through and why they're acting a certain way. And I have to go back, okay, how much sugar have they eaten that day? Did they get sleep last night? What has been on their mind the last couple of days? Oh, they have a birthday coming up. They're probably pretty stressed for that. So then I can figure that out.
So what you're saying here, I'm going to slow you down. What you're really saying here is like a mindset. You just think to yourself.
Correct.
You know, before you react, you're telling us, you actually think like about the basics, food, diet, sleep, all
I
that
do.
Stuff.
Because what I've witnessed is blowups, and we will have blowups, whether it's sibling blowups or individual blowups. But I can now forecast when a blowup is coming.
Hey, forecast.
Thankfully, I do that for a living.
The weatherman forecasts. Yes,
I can see certain triggers.
You can see. Tell us, wise one.
I know it's coming.
Yeah, because you're a present, connected parent, and you're listening and you're watching, so you can see. Tell us more, Mr. Weather.
So, as I know when this is coming, or if I've done the process of thinking about it, when a blow up happens, I don't react the way a typical parent would by yelling, go to your room. You don't treat your sister that way. You don't do that to your brother. You know, anything that could come off you know, maybe a bad parenting headline by us, you know, freaking out. And so once I know this, I can start implementing the whole, you know, wisdom into them. And they're getting to the age where they can start to understand it. And if I can slow them down for a second and have them actually focus in this world of ADD that we live in, and be like, listen to me, and then have a conversation. Connection. It actually, I can start to see it click. And it's pretty cool to see that happen as a parent.
Connection before correction, slow it down, think it through. Remind me of a lunch I had about 15 years ago. I was my friend, Joey Gordy. He's a missionary in India at that time. His whole family's got like 50 kids now. And he said, I said, what's it like over there in India? Because he's living in some of the worst, poorest parts of India. And he told me these stories. And one thing he told me is like, you know, they don't give their children's naps there. I was like, what do you mean?
At all.
Yeah, they don't nap. So the kids are so disobedient. Oh, they're always having temper tantrums. It's like these kids need sleep.
Yeah.
It's what you need, people.
Yeah.
Why don't you put your... He's got these toddlers and these younger kids that are not sleeping enough and their behavior is so bad. Isn't that interesting?
That's so interesting. I mean, yeah, I know when my kids have not gotten enough sleep, I can immediately tell we're going to have an interesting day, to say the least, right?
A lot of parents, we have one kid is like this more than the other, and you probably have at least one, maybe all your kids is like, they just know right away if that child has had enough to eat or not. It's like you can just see by their tone,
correct,
you need to eat. And then as soon as they eat, 5 minutes later, it's like magic potion. Do you have anybody in your family?
Oh, yeah.
Like that?
And the hard part too is like, I can be like, hey, you're tired. And they're like, well, no, I'm not. I'm not tired, Dad. We're like, no, trust me. I know you're tired. You got 6 hours of sleep last night. You're exhausted. Oh. No, I'm not. And bawling, you know, and you know they're tired, but they fight it. Why do they fight it? They don't want to be proven that they're, I'm like, just go to bed. You're going to wake up so much happier. That's the answer. And that's the cure. And you're not doing it.
It's the cure, stupid.
But
kids.
I mean, the way I try to parent, you know, my siblings when it comes to fighting is just, if they have a situation, you know, I'll immediately go to, okay, go to timeout. All right. And then once I wisen up, I'm like, okay, we have to talk to him about what just happened and kind of figure it out. But basically it's just every day doing a little bit. It doesn't have to be like, okay, once a week we sit down for 2 hours and we talk about our actions. No, it's like every day there's maybe a minute or 2 minutes where we just try to get it through to them as to how we treat each other in our family and how we're supportive with each other. And then buddy. I think it's rubbing off, man.
Yeah.
I think it's rubbing off. I hope so.
Well, that's you just said you're feeling it. You said
I'm feeling it. I'm getting good responses from their school teachers, you know, and so it's good. Oh, it's good to see that and like to hear that. But that's my family. That's what we're doing, and we're just trying. You know, we're all trying to wing this thing together. How do you manage sibling fighting?
Two part response. First one is, I'm going to say something edgy to you because you just said the word timeout. Okay.
I know.
How would
I know.
You feel about this? How would you feel if do I have permission? While we do this podcast together, to try to convince you to replace timeouts in your home with something different. Do I have permission to try to offer up some suggestions or some things to try to use instead of a timeout? And will you be open-minded to trying new things? And if it works for you, well, then maybe they'll stick and the timeouts can go. What do you think about this?
100%. We've already switched to using the word trust. Upon Sean Donahue's request, can I trust you to go to your room for 10 minutes?
Okay. Why are you laughing?
Because it's not a timeout. It's not called a timeout.
Okay. Yeah,
but I am trusting you to go to your room for 10 minutes and think about what you did.
Okay, I got you. Okay. Yeah, I think that was from a previous episode, The Power of the Word Trust. All right, thank you for permission. Let's keep chatting about that. All right, here's five quick tips to solve sibling fighting in your home. Number one, do not join the circus. Be the caring, connected adult in the relationship. Number two, do not force sharing with your kids. Force sharing doesn't teach sharing.
Ooh,
number three,
that's good.
Teach the difference between telling and tattletelling, and do not respond or allow tattletelling in your home.
Oh, I want to go deeper on that later.
Number
love it.
Four, play the role, my fellow parent, of the emotion coach. Your child's emotion coach, not the role of peacemaker, rescuer, or referee. Big difference in those roles.
Oh, I got to learn this
and
one.
And number five is use love and family meetings to build selflessness, teamwork, and love.
Those are big, man. I want to dive into each one of those. Okay.
Well, we don't have time for all
I know
five.
We don't, but I want to. We're going to extend this podcast by 4 hours, everybody.
I wanted to just do something different and just do like a rapid fire. Like out of those five things I just kind of barfed on you, do any of them, which one do you want to chat about?
Okay.
Which
first off,
like
force sharing. Force sharing. Okay.
Okay. We'll start with that. That's probably the only one we have time for.
All right.
Because I have like, I want to do like a more kind of formal 3-point, like ask the family coach. So yeah, force sharing, huh?
Okay. So force sharing. Don't force share between kids. Force sharing doesn't teach sharing. What I try to tell all, you know, I share, we share, we sometimes do like a 10 minutes. You have a 10 minutes, you have it, but let's go to technology
for
a second.
That would be an example of force sharing.
I know.
Right.
I know. Yeah. I'm just trying to be fair right now as a parent. I got twins. I'm just trying to balance everything.
Yeah. Oh,
I don't
want
to favor
this
anybody.
What most of us do is what I did too before I learned a different tool. And that's like the best way to teach sharing is by doing forced sharing.
It's sure.
Like, because they're two, they're three, they're one, and they want their toy.
Yeah. So let's go with technology for a second because I'm just going to go straight from what we have in my house. I try to limit it as much as possible. That's almost impossible. But we have one family iPad, right? And I will let you use the iPad a little bit each day, depending on how the day goes. Okay.
Okay.
And
yeah,
so
a little screen time. Sure.
Yeah. Let's just say, you know, one person has it for 10 minutes and then they give it to the other person. And then for some reason, the other person has an episode and I say, okay, you lose your iPad for that moment because you were mean to your brother, whatever it was. No fair. He had it for 10 minutes. I only had it for 5. And basically I try to tell everybody that nothing is yours.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing is my son's, nothing is my daughter's, nothing is mine, nothing is my wife's. It is ours. It is our family's. It is all of ours. So we all share it together. And I don't know if this is what I should be doing or not, but when they say it's mine, let's say someone got a gift for a birthday and they say it's mine, I don't want to let my brother or sister use it. It's not yours. You may have gotten that for your birthday, but it's all of ours. We all can share each other's things.
Okay.
So I don't know if that's right or wrong, but that's what I've been trying
to
do.
You know what? I'll just give you a couple ideas for you to consider. There's really like, this is kind of an edgy comment. There's no really right or wrong. in parenting and family life, you've got to do what is right for you, what feels right for you. I can just, is that cool that I said that first?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So when I first heard this concept about no force sharing, it was a long time ago, and that didn't really make sense to me. So I just kept learning more and more. So here's a couple of basics that I've learned is that one, in the Montessori background of people, they do a few things different in education and early childhood education. That's one of the things that many Montessoris do. Correct me if I'm wrong. If you have many people have more knowledge about Montessori education than I do, is like, hey, if you pick up a toy first, that's your toy. And you have as much time to play with it, so enjoy it. And then if another child wants to play with that toy, well, then they have to wait, because there's boundaries in life and you just can't grab things. Furthermore, these 5 foot and 6 foot giants called adults are not going to come in and violate your boundaries by grabbing something that was yours or was given to you for a birthday present or for a Christmas present and take it. So if you get something in life, well, then that is yours. Now, can you lose the privilege of playing with that? Well, absolutely. That would be a different episode on discipline, right? So if your daughter is playing with her toys or a doll and she's supposed to be in bed, you know, or if your teenager's on a screen at 11 o'clock and they should be asleep, well, then that would be a time for discipline. But the psychology is like, no, like in this home, we respect each other's boundaries. And I'll let you, I know you're going to ask me a couple follow-up questions, and that if you're playing with this, this is yours.
Yeah, but what if you only have one of something? Let's say I just bought this cool balloon launcher and we're launching water balloons and there's only one of them.
Right.
And one kid's like, well, I got it. I'm going to use all the balloons.
So, wonderful example. What is true sharing? Right? Everybody ask yourself, what is true sharing? Now to help, here's an analogy that I just thought of that will help me express my beliefs on sharing. What is true respect? Okay, so let's imagine a Pop Warner football team, and they're like seventh grade boys, and they have a bunch of grown men who are cussing at them, calling them names, threatening to bench them or making them do push-ups if they do not perform. This is not a fictional tale, everybody. This is real life. You with me, Jordan?
Yeah.
Do you think the players on those teams respect their coaches?
I would hope so.
I think the answer is absolutely yes. But what type of respect is it? My case for this illustration is that they are going to show outward respect, but not inward respect necessarily.
Because meaning outward, meaning by performance?
They're not going to say, they're not going to disrespect their coaches because they're afraid of their coaches.
Right.
They're going to obey their coaches and show respect because that's the social norm. That's the social expectation, but also out of fear of punishment.
They want to play.
But does that mean that they really enjoy these coaches, that they trust them, that they enjoy these men who grab their face masks and yell at them so much that spit comes off of these grown men's mouse into the mouse of a seventh grade child? Does that mean this child respects this coach inwardly? No, right?
Right.
Can you see there's a difference between outward respect and inward respect? So my case would be to truly teach respect at a Pop Warner level, you have to realize that there is such a thing as fake respect, and you've got to really reach the heart with love and respect to earn respect. This is my analogy. So with sharing, does force sharing actually teach sharing? I don't believe it does.
So we are hoping that we are teaching our children to the core of their heart, into their being, that they will have the know-it-all to share and be willing to share on their own.
Well, yeah, this is for me. I mean, I've got 18 and 13 and 6, so this isn't theory for me. Like, I put this into practice with all of our kids for 17 years now, 18 years. And it works. Now, I don't have a research right in front of me to prove it to you, but by telling my oldest daughter, Maddie, let's say when she's 7, or let's say 8, and that would make her younger sister at that time would be 4. So no, Maddie, this is your toy. You know, this is your thing. You don't have to play with it. Well, she's feeling safe around the big adults. She's feeling honored. And she's feeling respected, but she's also given the privilege to share, so that when she actually does share her toy with her 4-year-old sister It must make her feel so good because it's a genuine act of love.
Yes.
And by foresharing, you're robbing that opportunity from her, but you're also robbing it from the other sibling. Because if the sibling gets the toy, well, she's happy on the surface because they get the toy. But to get a toy or whatever it is from the sibling who's voluntarily now giving it, that is bonding right there.
That's good. That's
sibling
really good.
Love. You did this for me?
Yes.
Even though you got this from grandma and grandpa? And you're letting me play with your belongings? Thank you. I cherish that. And I will take good care of this because I know it's not mine. And now would you like to play with any of my toys?
Right. So I feel like I'm on the right path when it comes to nothing is yours, nothing is mine. And let's all be willing to share it with each other. And I want it to come from the bottom of their heart. So now I have.
But why? I was just like picking on you here. But why can't, if she gets a toy, why can't it be
yours?
You're
right. You're right.
Why not? I mean, it is hers. It says on her birthday present, it says to Emery.
Right.
It didn't say to Kemery.
You're right. You're right. You are not wrong in this situation. I guess in just trying.
Can she trust the adults in her life? Say, hey, this is my bedroom. You're not just going to barge in here and take my things. This is like, would you like for me to come and start grabbing your shirt and not listen to your words? And then if you act out, I'm going to go into your house. I'm going to steal your Emmys and I'm going to punish you. That kind of sounds so cool. Steal your Emmys? Like, dude, that is so cool, man, that you have Emmys.
I don't know where you came up with this.
It's a great example because you don't want anyone stealing your Emmys, do you? I mean, that's dope. You have an Emmy. How many Emmys do you have?
I only have one. Jordan, I have one Emmy, and I have one. Best? I have one Edward R. Murrow Award, but they just sit collecting dust.
No, they don't. Don't minimize these accomplishments.
They're just things, Sean. Cool.
Best? Were you the best weather personality in the whole Pacific Northwest?
Yeah, it was the Northwest Regional Emmy. Yeah, and it came down to the best meteorologist in the market. And
yeah,
I don't know how I got it, but anyway, I got that one. So it's cool.
That's so great.
It's very cool.
Would you like me next time you act out? Say, hey, man, you've lost your Emmy for like 12 months and I'm going to take it to my house.
Right.
I mean, that's weird, right?
I know.
That's punishment.
I get where you're coming from. Yes.
Is that going to teach you to be a better man or to trust me or like me if I'm going to steal your Emmys?
No, you're right. You're right. This is
going to make you want to hide from me.
I'm already figuring out how I'm going to parent tonight going forward with what I know is going to happen with the new hoverboard that we got. And, they each want to ride on it. So this is really good, man.
Yeah, another episode we'll do like here's another tool to use the hoverboard. if you have twins, or if you've got kids ages like 12 and up. In my opinion, I have a little list. It's called Sean's Top 10 Parenting Tools. In my opinion, this tool is in the top 10. It should be in the top 5. If you have teenagers. It's called Shared Problem Solving. Which we'll talk about that another time in a different episode, but here's a little sample of it. Hey guys, we have one hoverboard and you're twins. And I don't want to control this. I don't want to force you to share. So what should we do about this? Shared problem solving. What should we do? Now you're going to engage their brain in problem solving so that by the time at age 9, by the time they're 15, they'll be much more advanced in problem solving than their peers who don't have twins.
Man, that's so wise.
It makes me think of the Smith twins, the Smith triplets.
The Smith triplets, yeah.
Like, why were they so wise? Well, because they lived with, all these other roommates and they had to figure it out together.
Yeah. I really want to dive in about the tattletelling, but I know we have limited time here. So maybe we can break that down on another episode if you're okay with that.
Well, I think happy siblings, happy homes is a really important part of having a healthy home and being a healthy parent. So this is why it's just called part one.
Right.
So, yeah, man. So tell us how it goes. Why'd they get a new hoverboard?
Geez, now you're having me think on the spot here. I want to say, it's not new. It was a Christmas gift, but it was for one of the kids and the other kid really wants to ride it also. And when the other kid rides it, the one who got it for the birthday is like, that's mine. You didn't ask. Mm-hmm. And to me, I'm like, well, they don't have to ask. You weren't even in the house. You were outside playing. Why can't they jump on the hoverboard real quick? But I need to listen to that. And that kid is saying, hey, I would like it if you ask. And so I need to do what you are saying and bring awareness to the situation so that hopefully they can talk it out with each other and it's not a fight.
Like, we'll have a whole episode one day on shotgun rules. Because for some families, that's like, who sits in the shotgun driving the car? That's like, did you know? That's like, it's like, just solve this problem for me, Sean.
Right.
Just, I need to know. It's like, it's ruining my kids.
You got to call it.
Shotgun. But then what if they...
But you can't call it unless you see the car. You have to step outside to see the car to call. There's rules. I get it.
Right. And then even if there's blended families and they have different shotgun rules.
Yeah.
Like shotgun. Like, that was a hard season of our parenting. Thankfully, that season was like 4 or 5 years ago where our kids were arguing about who sits in what chair. Oh, my gosh.
We did the same thing, man.
Maybe some of you judge me when I said kids can be so annoying sometimes. You judge me. Oh, Sean, you shouldn't say that. You're a parent coach. Well, you know what? It's just, you don't have kids then. You just listen to that.
That's good. That's really good. Right. But now we got to move on to the section, which we all love, and it's called Ask the Family Coach.
Oh, I love this section. So how does this sound? I'll just share. I'll go three tips and tools for all of us. I'll do 3, 2, 1, because I think number one is by far the most important. I'll just do one at a time, and then you give me your take on each one. Now, if those of you are listening, please get a pen out because I have a phone number for you. I have a new Google Voice phone number. And this number is, if you would like to call it, you can leave a 30 to 60 second question for us, for Jordan and I, to address on the show. Or if you like the show and you're learning something, tell us why you like it. Or three, if you have a topic that you'd like us to address more on the show or for the first time, please call the number. Leave me a message and you might end up on this podcast.
Is that cool
idea, Jordan?
Yeah, that's cool. That's good.
And you can also contact me through the YouTube, you can email me, or you can find it on TikTok or Instagram or all those things. So here's three things of how we thrive with sibling rivalry, sibling fighting. And first, number three, is we want to embrace these roles. So everybody, you are not the referee. Take off those white and black striped shirts. And I want you to embrace the role of the emotion coach. You want to see yourself not as the peacemaker, not as the person in the middle. You want to coach them because they are never going to receive emotion coaching outside this home. Parents are teachers and every home is a school. So we want to teach them, how do we thrive with challenging siblings who are different than us? How do you manage your emotions when you really want to sit in your one chair in the car, but then the other person wants to sit there too? How do you thrive when you're twins and maybe you get one present and it says for the twins? How are you guys going to do that? Do you want me just to control this? Do you want me to make a chart? Or do you want to work together? Right. So think of this. If you could think about who, Jordan, do you have a name coming up for you right now? Do you have a teacher in your elementary, middle, or high school, or even college? That was like your favorite teacher.
Oh, yeah.
You love this person. Like, who is this person? Why did you love them? Who is this person? Just putting you on the spot.
Oh, I got two that come to mind. This is high school. Who comes to mind? I got Mr. Kelso. It was, I want to say, senior English at high school. And then you've got Miss Hambution, which is my high school drama teacher, both instilling like life goals and more than just being a teacher, you know?
Yeah.
Being a role model.
And I had a feeling with these teachers, you kind of felt seen by this teacher. Like, this teacher really gets me, believes in me.
Yeah. And maybe even more than that. Maybe it's like they challenge us in a way that's not forcing us to do something. It's like, let me give you an example. Mm-hmm. Reading. I did not like to read. I hated reading. But Mr. Kelso was so good at explaining why reading was so cool and the cool things coming out of this book that it made me want to read. And so I'm like, oh man, this is cool. So instead of forcing me, you read this book. We talked about it and now I'm deciding, oh, reading is cool.
I love that story because we want to be the cool teachers that the kids love. We can do this. We want to lead with love and parent with love because if our goal is to teach our kids wisdom and emotional intelligence and sharing and beauty and love and family love, Well, the best way we can do that is to be the most loving, connected parents we can be, right? Like, we want to lead and teach with love, and we want to be their role model. So that's action step number one, is be their role model. Be the adult in the relationship. Be the hero that they need. And what do I mean by hero? One of my literary mentors is called Dr. Laura Markham. Her book that I read about 18 years ago, it changed my life, and it got me going on this path of being a family coach. Here's a quote I want to read to y'all from the introduction of her book, Peaceful Parent, Happy Siblings. Okay, listen to this. As she talks about emotion coaching and presence and patience and just being available to your kids and doing the slow path of parenting, because really that's what, you know, that's why we control, that's why we force, that's why we do so much of what we do, is because it makes us feel better, and it's the we don't want to sit in the pain. We want quick answers, quick results. So she writes, coaching your children so they develop emotional intelligence is what transforms their relationships with each other. There will be some days when you simply can't get to the dishes, the laundry, the emails. The only way to keep your children from bashing each other will be to sit on the floor with them to prevent the fights, to coach them to express their needs without attacking, and to find ways to transform tension into closeness with laughter or with tears. This is heroic work, especially because it's so private. No one is there to see what it costs you, but it's not as invisible as it seems. Just as a tree's rings record environmental conditions year by year, your children's experience now is creating the people they're growing into. Every day, you are literally shaping who your children will be for the rest of their lives. And don't worry, there's also a very immediate payoff, which you'll see in increasingly positive interactions between your children. Isn't that just
That's
amazing
beautiful.
writing?
That's
Gosh,
beautiful.
that's such great
Deep.
writing.
It's deep. And you know, often my kids will bring up, it's not fair. That's one of their excuses to things. It's just not fair. And I guess that's where my teaching comes to wanting things to be fair. Let me force sharing so that it's fair. But the reality is, who ever said life was supposed to be fair? We need
It's
to
not. It's
teach that
not.
from within
It's
rather than
not.
being the referee, as you mentioned.
That actually really builds up for my second point for Asset Family Coach. Second point is, don't distract, teach. Let me explain. What we have in so many modern parenting books is we have a culture of distraction. So we have people telling you that when your 5-year-old is going through X, Y, and Z, to distract them with a new toy, change the subject, to get their mind off of this. And this can be some really great advice. We've all actually all done this. In this scenario, we could have, okay, we've got two twins that are sibling over one hoverboard. Totally makes sense. Well, what could we do? In the heat of the moment, you could be like, well, here, you play with the hoverboard and you play with that. So you're distracting them from sitting in the tension of the moment. You feeling me? We could see a whiny sibling saying, who got their button pushed, which is called being treated unfairly, and they're whining and they're ex like exploring these emotions of what it feels like to be treated unfairly. And we want to distract them from that pain, and we want to distract ourselves from this. So we yell at them, we scold them, we label them, we psychologize them, we threaten them, because we want the behavior to stop, because we want to feel better. This is what we all do. We've all done it. Do you agree?
Yeah, and I think that's probably because it's just easier than to teach. It takes more effort to teach, but that's the smart thing to do.
And it distracts ourselves from the pain of being present in the moment, because we don't want to be in pain. It's painful. You with me? So we're constantly being tempted to distract ourselves. Pick up a phone, pick up some food, pick up some alcohol, force some sharing, threaten the kids, send them to their room, put them in the naughty chairs, 1, 2, 3, because we do not want to be the adult in the relationship and sit in that tension Does this ring familiar to you?
Yeah. Again, it's the easier option, right? Let me just
Yeah, man.
check out. Let me check out.
Right.
But we can't check out as parents. What's your last tip?
Now, I think the last tip is the most important, and it's the one that people do not use the most, and it's the least talked about. In fact, we're going to have a whole episode on this tip. You know, you might have a poster in your house or a home goods print that says family first or in this family or family rules. And it might say some nice things on there about this or about this or about what your priorities are. But if you have one sibling who is hurting another sibling or abusing them or treating them poorly, and then you drive them to their softball practice or their soccer game, you are sending that child a strong message about what your priorities are. You with me?
Keep going.
Okay, thank you. If you
Well, I'm
have
just,
one
I want,
sibling
yeah,
who's
go ahead.
really treating family members poorly, even treating you poorly, lacking chores, lacking respect, or just being really nasty to their sibling, and then you give them extra screen time, or you buy them certain things, or you give them their special meal that they requested, you are sending
Yes.
them a message about what's important to you,
Got it.
right?
Yes.
So when I say the number one tip is to put family love at the tippy top of your list overall, you really have to understand the depth of really what that means. We all want your siblings to love each other and to love their family members and to have a house of love. But you know how much intention that is going to require for you? Because if you are letting your kids treat each other poorly or treat you poorly or not respond to your emotion coaching, but then you do all these things for them, you're sending a message to them that soccer and softball and their special ham and cheese sandwich is more important than family. And this is what many of us have done, and you are now reaping what you've sown. You've got a kid who's on time for their sports practice because being on time might be important to you. You've got a kid who may be on time to school. They might have A's and B's, but do you have a home where the siblings really love each other and care and put family first? Do you think about
I'm just letting
prioritizing
it breathe for
family
a
love
second because
at
a
the
lot of
tip of
us,
all?
we have not done that. Why is that? You're right. We're so focused on outside things, we tend to neglect the things that's the most important on the inside.
I think it's hard to sit in that tension, right? Trying to teach love and selflessness, because at the root of almost all, not all, almost all sibling rivalry is selfishness, right? Is selfishness.
Yeah.
And so what is love? You know, love is selflessness. It's giving, it's charity, it's sacrifice, it's putting others' needs before your own. It's compassion. Love is gentle. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not boast. Love just keeps no record of wrongs. This is a verse out of the Bible. So what when we think about, you know, how to raise happy sibling, happy homes, really what we're talking about, the love. How do we teach our kids what the definition of love is, and that love is the answer and love is the way?
Especially if we as adults don't even know what love is, we got to come back and find that so that we can instill
We
that.
get distracted, right? We get distracted with our screens and
Maybe
our
we've been hurt by
jobs.
love.
We get distracted by laundry. We get afraid of love. We get afraid of being vulnerable because
Yeah.
it doesn't, we want love, but we don't want to get hurt, which we either just to
Right.
put the kids into the minivan and take them to soccer rather
Right.
than talk about how this family needs to grow in love. You know? As we close our show, when I think about an attitude of gratitude, I think of what happened last night. Last night, we had some friends over for dinner, and they were here a long time, lunch and dinner. And they were like, let's go get some froyo. So we went down the street and we got some frozen yogurt together. And my 18-year-old daughter called us up. I think she talked to my wife and she says, what are you guys doing? And we said, oh, we're going out with Charlie and Sarah's family. We're going to Froyo. And she said, oh, can I come? So she drove out of her friends and she met us at Froyo and she did not order any frozen yogurt, Jordan.
Oh, she just wanted to be with you.
She just wanted to be with us. And I'm just so thankful for that moment. And I should tell her
That's
because I haven't even told
beautiful.
her how much
You should
she's
tell
doing a lot of little things like that to show us that she loves this family and she's 18. And she was probably exhausted because she was out with her friends from 9 in the morning till 8 p.m. She could have easily gone home, but she didn't even order frozen yogurt, man. How cool was that?
That's so cool. You should tell her.
Tell us something,
My attitude of
attitude of
gratitude. Yeah,
gratitude. What are you thankful for?
we just celebrated birthdays, and with the twins and their individuality, we each gave them their own little party, so to speak. And one of the things we did was like a fun sleepover, right? For my daughter, we had a fun sleepover, had some girls over, did a tea party. It was so great. But we did a lot of decorating, and you may have seen it in the last episode or heard me talking about it. Little teepees, they had their little sleep areas, and one of the kids was in here and ripping down all the decor. And my daughter was like, hey, stop that. Stop that. Do you know how long my dad worked on that, getting this ready? And I was just
Oh my
like,
gosh.
that's really cool. She knew how much time we spent putting it all up for her. I thought that was
Yeah,
really
man.
cool. I thought that was great.
He said little, it's things like that. They're little, but they're so big, huh?
I know. And you're right. We should make sure we tell our kids when we become aware of those moments. You should tell your daughter that. I should tell my daughter that I'm proud of what she said. But to everybody listening, this has been a very deep podcast. I've learned a lot. I know you learned a lot. We're all in this together, and there's going to be a lot more fights coming your way. I know I'm going to have more fights coming my way. Let's just be real, okay? Sibling rivalries, jealousy, teaming up on each other, whatever it is. But I mean, with these teachings, we do a little each day. My hope is that all of us can become better parents. We're in this together. Let's limit the fights and do our best to keep happiness and love flowing through our children. Happy parenting, everybody.